Good afternoon, everyone.
Hello.
Welcome to MMS. So my name is Santos Martinez. Today's session is about SQL Server for System Center 2012.
And I am Brett Bennett. I am from Dallas, Texas. Santos is from Tampa, Florida.
Yeah, so welcome to New Orleans, right?
So June welcome in New Orleans.
Welcome to New Orleans, and I guess this is June. Yeah? So, again, April, welcome to the city of Las Vegas in Nevada. So I guess it's April now, right? So we're doing MMS. So for some of you that know, last year we were thinking of doing it in New Orleans. So
in June, yeah.
Yeah, so I guess that's an internal joke for all of us, right? So again, welcome everyone. We're happy to have you here for today's session. So let's begin the fun here. So how many of you, when you start talking about SQL Server, put this face? This is actually Blake Griffin from Los Angeles. Los Angeles Clipper, right? He was the 2012 slam dunk champion, but I guess he was having some kind of trouble when we started talking about SQL,
yeah,
in here,
definitely.
Right? So I guess you put that face when I say, "Hey, for System Center, I actually need SQL Server." So I put that face too when people start talking about some other things that are not a basketball.
Speaking of basketball, so like Final Two tomorrow, right? Tomorrow night.
So
Louisville, Michigan.
How many from Michigan here?
Louisville, anybody?
Louisville? Great, great.
Couple, Michigan?
So the NCAA championship tomorrow, I think,
yeah,
right?
Exactly.
So the odds should be good, so it's Las Vegas. Make sure to check that out.
So System Center 2012 is a great set of products, enterprise-ready products, best-of-breed products, great set of suite of things, do all kinds of cool things for your IT environments. They have a couple things in common. One would be the same framework, has the same framework in place in common, right? But what else beyond that is common about System Center 2012?
They also have another thing in common. Besides that framework that Brett just told you guys, we also have SQL Server as the back end. So it's a shared common thing between all the System Center products to have and use SQL Server. So that's the main focus of today's session, focusing on what we do and what we need in terms of SQL Server to support those System Center products.
So properly installing SQL Server is really critical to making System Center products work as they should. It's really important to specify and deploy hardware and software that can meet the demands of SQL Server for your products. Configuring SQL correctly could cause things like high CPU, maybe some file backlogs, maybe memory shortages on your site servers and such, maybe some workflow delays, orchestrator and things, maybe some stale inaccurate data and reporting and such. So generally, like I said, configuring SQL correctly could cause some serious issues with your environment as far as System Center products goes.
Great. So it's important to carefully consider and plan for this volume of data, right? So one of the products may have one kind of SQL load, and the other may have another SQL table load. But it's important for you guys to plan ahead of time before we actually start building the SQL environment for those System Center products. So our today agenda will be focused on some of these areas. One of the areas is identify what is new in SQL Server 2012 and how can benefit those System Center products. We're going to talk about the different memory configurations that we have for different products and how to set them up, right?
Absolutely.
How to identify the different memory pressures. As engineers, we often have to go into our customer site and troubleshoot some of the memory performance issues that a SQL Server can create. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, too, during today's session. Other thing that we're going to talk about is what are those performance monitors that I can do? What are some of those actions that I can take as a proactive engineer to check how is my performance of those SQL boxes? So we're going to talk a little bit about that, too. We're also going to talk about the different database options. One of the database options is autogrow. So many of you better be familiar with it, but we want to bring it up, some of the things that we need to go and configure in terms of those database options.
Yes.
We're also going to talk about some of the clustering benefits that we have. What is always on? How do I benefit from clustering in a System Center environment? And something I call it the all-in-one cluster. So we're going to talk about that. And then at the end, we're going to talk about the different benefits of SQL Server and those System Center products.
Great. So SQL 2012 has been out for about a year now, right, Santos? April last year, I think,
came out.
So about a year out on this product. It's our new SQL platform for all products, really. Things that it has benefits around: increased performance, scalability, has enhancements around Power View, so we can do advanced reporting services functionality in SharePoint. We also have a new add-in for Excel for a call Power Pivot for, again, more charts and graphs and cool Excel documents and such, as well PowerShell support, as everything has. PowerShell now is a huge part of all products. PowerShell support for data automation. And the last big one, always on. So what is always on?
Talk to me a little bit more about always on.
So always on is this it's a fairly new concept in SQL, of course. It's a new feature 2012 has. What it allows you to do is set high availability and disaster recovery for your SQL servers. It allows you to create availability groups for your databases, allows you to create a failover cluster instance for SQL Server instances, as well as using this Windows Server failover clustering as the underlying platform. Several product system centers support this functionality. We'll have a slide on that in a moment. But big thing here, this requires SQL Server Enterprise Edition.
Right, that's right.
Versus standard, right? So there's some licensing costs around that you be aware of for you deploying this. Requires the enterprise for this always-on piece to work in System Center 2012.
What products do actually support always-on?
So there's a link here at the bottom. As of now, today, we support always-on in App Controller. Who uses App Controller in this environment? Anybody? A couple of hands?
A couple guys. Great.
Okay, cool. App Controller supports always-on. Operations Manager does as well. Orchestrator supports always-on. Service Manager and Virtual Machine Manager. So what products at this point don't support always-on? Data Protection Manager, DPM, is one. And a lot of questions on this one. Config Manager, Configuration Manager, does not at this point support always-on.
Right? Yeah, I have got many questions from my customers about that. You know, whether or not we support always-on to the different System Center product. As a Config Manager engineer, I tend to tell her, yeah, at this point we haven't tested out for Config Manager, yeah. But definitely there are a lot of other products in our suite that will support and benefit from the always-on.
So at this point, we don't know if or when it ever will, but that's something we can talk about hopefully this week with the product team. But it says now there's no, that we know of any plans to support always on. Again, that may change tomorrow. We just don't know at this point.
Great. So let's talk about our SQL memory. I mentioned that those one of the things that we got to check and validate that is properly set up on some of your system center. So let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about SQL memory. In terms of SQL memory, there are two specific parts that we should focus in terms of the memory. One of those is actually the buffer pole. The buffer pole, you actually support many areas. So when you start talking about the buffer pole, it's basically the way SQL servers stack the memory. Either segregate the memory to be used for the different logs and the pages into that buffer memory. When you set up the minimum amount of memory for SQL and the maximum amount of SQL to be used, you basically stack between the buffer pole and the SQL engine, which is the other part. In terms of the SQL engine, he actually identified what are those buffer poles that he needs and how much memory will be used and how much memory should leave for them to use in another process, depending on how they actually support in those areas. So what is actually that maximum memory? And many of you have read this through all our documentation. We start reading about System Center 2012. We actually need a minimum recommendation in memory, and we need a maximum recommendation in terms of memory. In terms of the maximum memory, we normally recommend to have a SQL memory on the server between the 50% and 80% of that memory from that SQL Server box, which means if the SQL Server box itself has 16 gigabytes of RAM, for that specific instance, we got to try to set it up between that 50% and that 80% in terms of the maximum setup. So it's very important for you guys to do this. In terms of how that will start, that doesn't mean that we'll try to use that maximum memory right away. And that is another setting that is actually called the minimum amount of memory. I will talk to you guys now about the minimum amount of memory. We have read this through all of the documentations, is what we need in terms of the minimum amount of memory. For example, in Configuration Manager, the minimum amount of memory to be used is 80 gigabytes, which is 8192. What that means is that the moment that instance starts, you're going to go and maximize that buffer flow and that SQL memory to leave in the maximum, in the minimum of that amount of RAM. So for the minimum, we're normally going to set up as 8192, and for the maximum, we're going to have some memory to leave, which is probably going to be 1024, which is 10 gigabytes, so we don't consume all the 16 gigabytes from that SQL server that we just talked about, and it's something that we got to set up once for every single instance. So let me show you guys how we actually set up this memory in terms of SQL Server and how we do all that. About that. So I'm going to log in into my SQL server here. I'm going to show you guys how to set it up. So at this point, I'm already logged on into my SQL server. So I'm going to guide you through the step-by-step process to go and set this up into the database. So the first thing we have to do is actually go into the properties of this SQL server. So we go in here, and I'm going to show you guys. Let me zoom in a little bit so you guys can actually take a look. Oh, I think I can't zoom it from here. Well, anyway, let me hit properties in here. Then after that, I'm going to go into memory. Notice that we have two different types of configuration, either the configured values or the running values. If I set up the memory now, it will be a running value. So then later on, I need to set up the minimum amount of memory to something that is lower or higher than that memory setting that I will do. So to give an example, when we talk about that minimum memory, we got to go in here and we got to type 8192 to make sure that we set up that memory in here. It looks like we have right now a maximum of 2 terabytes, right? So if I don't set it up this, and I leave it like this, what is going to happen on that SQL server? You're going to, instead of that memory leave, it's going to try to use as much amount of memory for that SQL server box. And then we're going to start creating something I call memory pressures. And I'm going to show you guys that later on in my presentation.
And we do a lot of health checks, and we a lot of times see where it's been left defaults, where it's SQL can use whatever memory it wants to in the box, which is, again, it's a concern. So eliminate definitely is something you guys should think about in your environments doing.
That's right. So for example, in here, I set up that minimum to 8192 and then a maximum of 10 to 40, which is around 10 gigabytes, right? So if I don't want to repeat and do this on all my boxes, I could either go into the script, I can set script to file, and I will be able to save that in terms of a script. I can set configure SQL min and max memory. And I can later on do this in every single of my instances. So I talk about memory pressures, and I said, if we don't set up that up, you see those terabytes that I was by default is assigned to that SQL memory, what's going to happen is going to start creating different memory pressures on that server. So we're going to result on many excessive IOs or even in a lot of memory utilization as part of that box. So what I tend to do is actually troubleshoot that server, identify what are those memory pressures and how I can do that. So we can use a utility that is part of the operating system, which is performance monitor. So we're using performance monitor, we're taking a trap of that performance counter. If we go, instead of a trap of maybe 2 hours or 3 hours in terms of the SQL server memory, we can start doing it basically a few identify. I normally focus on three main things in those areas. Number one is the page life expectation of that amount of time that we're using in terms of the IO. When actually those buffer pool memory is not basically utilized, either start doing some lazy writers into the memory, and I can take those traps into my performance mode, or I can see on the buffer pool that it's having some sort of memory pressure. So if you open performance counter and start saying buffer manager in the SQL, you can open those three areas, and you can start identifying where are my pressures and how I can solve this. So my number one point right there is, if you start seeing some of these performance impact in some of your SQL boxes, go ahead and check the minimum amount of memory and the maximum amount of memory of those SQL Server boxes to make sure they're not having issues. In terms of performance counters, that can do many more things. So I bring that up because I normally, as an engineer, troubleshoot this type of problems a lot of times. So besides those performance counters I just told you guys, there are more specific things that we can check in terms of every single performance counter. One of them will be the buffer manager. If, for example, in buffer manager, we have the cache hit ratio. This counter indicates, right? Let me get that word correctly, right? Indicates whether or not that SQL server is having some pressure in that buffer. This doesn't mean that it's writing to the hard drive, but it actually means that it's writing to the SQL server memory of that box. So if we open that up and start identifying, hey, I'm having some latencies in writing and reading from that memory, that could be an indicator that it's having some memory pressures on that SQL server box. Then the other thing is actually the free pages, the total number of pages for all free lists in terms of SQL Server. So when we start looking at that, we will identify whether or not it's having some memory issues in those areas. Then we have the lazy writers. The lazy writers can have performance between the memory, CPU, and even the hard drive. So just make sure that you take a look at some of these pressures in terms of the performance counters. Other ways for monitoring the SQL performance, besides you enabling that performance and taking a trap for 2 hours, you can leave it open for a while, and you can start reading those performance counters. You can either go and zoom in a little bit much better, so you can identify some of this pressure in the target. You can either do the perf counter and tell how much the memory is being utilized at that moment. You can either check the memory manager, set some of the total memory size, and see, hey, actually the total memory that has been used is more than I actually assigned it to it. And that could be an indicator of that maximum amount of memory is not set up, and it's trying to overutilize that memory that was not assigned to that SQL server. So other things that you can basically start monitoring, besides that memory that we have indicated to you guys a couple times, is actually the CPU. And I have seen this happening many times, right?
Absolutely.
When I go into the site, when I go in on site to troubleshoot a problem, and it's not necessarily a problem of the SQL server. It's just that the processing time of that CPU is not enough to handle the data. So what happened is I decided to build a virtual machine. This happened many times. And when I build that virtual machine, I assign two CPUs. And when I assign that to two CPUs, I decide to put a maximum weight for that virtual machine. So sometimes fighting against resources for other virtual machine on that server. And that may happen. So a processor time could be a good indicator that is not having enough processing time for that virtual machine that's maybe fighting in the host for some of these pressures. Other ways for you to monitor these pressures in the system is actually to leverage one of the system center products. If you use Operations Manager and you download this management pack, you can either start monitoring your own databases to check whether or not they're having issues. So instead of you doing this process that I talked to you guys manually, you could leverage System Center. If you leverage Operations Manager and you download this management pack, you can set up the management pack, download it into those SQL Server boxes, and you can start being alert about those issues. So at least it's going to point you to the right direction. Even for you start to guess whether it's my problems, you could leverage into this product to have a much better understanding of what's going on. Here is a link. If you guys want to start playing and downloading some of these configuration management packs for your System Center product, you could basically download from this link. It's a reference on the PowerPoint, so once we finish the presentation, it will be available to you guys, so you guys can start having those resources.
Absolutely. So one thing databases do is they change size. They grow typically, right? So as we add more clients or managed servers, whatever it is, the database grows. So auto-growing is a part of SQL databases, of course. But auto-growing too small, or auto-growing in small chunks is a bad thing potentially, right? So auto-growing in 1 megabyte chunks or whatever could be an issue. If we spend a lot of time auto-growing our database, what happens is we start seeing an accumulation of virtual log files, VLF files. Start seeing a lot of those files. For example, if you have 250 or so, you may see a little performance hit on SQL Server based on that occurring. We start seeing a lot of VLF files, 10,000 perhaps. We might see a long time getting SQL databases servers started running on the box. So definitely auto-growing is, again, a normal thing. We expect that. But auto-growing in small chunks is a negative thing potentially, right? So again, and the converse, there's – go forward one. Yeah. The converse, auto-growing too large also could be an issue. Auto-growing maybe in 100 gigabyte or maybe 10 gigabyte chunks might be too much, right? So too small, not good. Too large may cause more issues around. For example, auto-growing in large chunks may cause the SQL to write zeros in the space for that space that was just grown and cause issues with recurring issues around maybe inserting updates or deletes to the data may be blocked because of an auto-grow occurring in a larger scale for the larger auto-grow setting, right? We can enable an instant file initialization for the database. But it may cause a slight security risk because basically that area is exposed during this auto-grow process. It may cause some data that has been deleted in that growth section may be available by some tools to analyze the data and maybe get some data out of it. So, again, auto-growing too large could be an issue as well around security as well.
And planning for the initial size in the database is very important too. So if you have an estimated amount of data that you're going to put in each of these databases, it is good for you to estimate what is going to be the growth ahead of time. So the initial size may be 5 gigabytes, right? But if you plan ahead of time and say, yeah, I think my database could be about 10 gigabytes of size. You could basically go and say, my initial size will be 10 gigabytes, and then the growth could be between 500 megabytes or so.
Exactly.
So how about some demo about that, Brett?
That's an excellent idea. Going back to our virtual server here, so we have our management studio opened up for SQL Server 2012. We're going to go into our config manager database here, which is, in this case, CMMMS. We're going to go into properties for our database, so right-click and choose properties. We're going to go into files. And we're going to configure the auto-grow setting for this database. So by default, the auto-grow, I think it's 2% out of the box in config manager in 2012. We're going to adjust that to something a little bit bigger than the smaller auto-grow setting has already been set. So we go into the configuration here. This is our database file here we're looking at. So we go into here, we choose a configuration option here. We're going to set this to grow in megabytes. So it's right now it's 1%. Again, one, maybe too small of an auto growth setting. So we're going to change this to something a little bit larger. We're going to change it to say megabytes, and we're going to go ahead and say our database is 5 gig in this environment. We're going to say 10% of that for our auto growth. Does that sound about right, Santo? So let's set that sucker for about 500 megabytes for our new auto growth setting, okay? So we're going to apply that setting by saying okay here. I've now changed the auto growth setting for my database. Let's go ahead and change the transaction log as well. Same idea. We need to basically allow that to auto grow in a little bit bigger chunks perhaps than it was initially. So let's go into here. And same idea. Our transaction log is about 468 meg or so. Let's go ahead and change that to the same idea, say 10%. So we're going to say this, maybe we're going to auto-grow this maybe by 50 megabytes, for example. Okay? So apply that change. We're going to say OK. We've now set the auto-grow settings for our database and our transaction log both very quickly in the console and done, and we apply that, and we're good. We're auto-grow now is set really where it really should be probably for this environment.
So instead of growing every small chunks at a time, which it can cause several issues on the queue. Let's say you're performing a transaction, and in the middle of that transaction, the database will grow. And that could actually take some other performance impact in your server besides actually just the weight that we have on that server itself.
Exactly. So TempDB is used heavily in SQL and system-centered products. We make heavy use of TempDB database. So pre-sizing that database file might be a great idea rather than relying on auto-grow to get it where it should be size-wise. We can pre-identify that TempDB database size may save us some auto growth cycles down the road, okay? Typically, we recommend setting a fixed amount to a grow frequent auto growth setting. So again, auto growth should be set properly to minimize auto growths down the road as we deploy our environments. Okay. One recommendation here is, though, as well, I don't see this done quite as often as we probably should, but dividing TempDB into multiple database files, right, Santo? So
right.
One data file per CPU up to 8 CPUs is kind of our guidance for that, right?
Right. So planning for 10 databases is very important. And how many of you forget about this? We set it up, the SQL, we put the database on, and that's it. We say, well, we're done deal. But this is not basically done deal because we have a 10 database that are going to start writing information from each of the products. Mm-hmm. So it's good to plan for that size too, and it's good to plan for different performance impacts. So if you create one 10 database file for each CPU, then up to 8 CPUs, you will definitely get a better performance in that SQL Server box. So if
Absolutely.
You want to read more information about some of this, here is a good link, again, a good reference for the presentation. So when you guys actually download the presentation, you can take a look at some of these options.
So another important issue around SQL configuration is making sure our database storage is properly configured. Typically, we recommend having our transaction logs and database files being on separate physical disks, perhaps, so different disks. So maybe our transaction logs on the F drive and our database files are on the E drive, for example. So splitting those off is kind of a best practice around SQL planning for our databases and our transaction logs. Also recommend having at least 20% of disk space available on the server for operations, so we're not constrained on disk space issues and such. Make sure we have adequate space to store data and write data to the server environment. Right.
Right. I think those are very important key messages in terms of storage. Designing where you're going to put each of those files, the database file on one drive, in terms of I/O, you're going to have better performance. You put the log files in another drive, so you can have different type of performance. So what about physical or virtual? That's a question I get a lot.
Yeah, so we get this a lot with customers. They ask us, we're deploying our product systems and our products. Should we use a physical environment or a virtual environment? Which is better? You know, there's no better. They have differences. They have benefits of each other, right? So how we typically recommend is, you know, it depends on the environment, right, Santa? So
right, it all depends. So what do you all think? Should I have it a virtual? Should I have it actually local? Is that question many of you always ask, right? If this is a product that supports virtualization or is it not a product that supports virtualization? What do you say, Brad?
Yeah, so it's definitely supported. We support running our products on VMware, Hyper-V. It's all supported. That's not a concern at all. Main concern we have is around performance. Can the VM host keep up with demand from our products on running as guests in the computer and in the environment? For example, so there's some benefits around running virtually, right?
Right.
We have, example, reduced server hardware costs, maybe less physical servers. We buy single servers with lots of space and such to store run lots of guest OSs, right?
So there is definitely a lot of benefits in virtuals, right? Our main recommendation in this is to always read what we said in terms of recommendation of minimum amount of memory, minimum amount of CPU, and in terms of disk space, right? Check those recommendations that we put together on the technical library. So even that it's virtual, it should at least meet some of those minimum requirements. If it doesn't meet those minimum requirements, you can bet that it will not perform the way you want it, even that it's physical or if it's a virtual machine.
Exactly. So if you use virtual servers, number one thing is make sure that virtual server host can handle the load you're about to put onto it, right? Don't take your already production environment, the virtual environment, and load up your server to expect that good things to perhaps happen. It might cause issues, as well as you might see in the environment, right? So things like we may see issues around slow disks, low memory, high CPU, could be things that have impact on System Center. We need to make sure we're putting our guest server computers onto a VM host that can handle the additional load we're going to place on it with these products.
Right. Another thing that normally happens is when we set up the VHD files, instead of dedicating the amount of space right away when we set it up, we put dynamic space. What happens is you got SQL Server writing information into the drive, let's say into the database MDF file or to the log file. But in the back end, the host is actually trying to expand because it's not having enough space. So it's very important for you guys not to enable dynamic VHD files for some of these virtual machines that you have in the production environment. It's better if you set up the amount of space that you need now, and later on you can expand that drive. So I think it's much better to do that ahead of time so it doesn't create any performance issue in that moment. So again, local or remote in terms of the SQL Server?
Another question we get a lot of, so which is better? Again, it depends on the environment. It depends on how the product's being utilized, how big your environment is and such. It depends on a lot of things, right, Santos?
Right. Yeah. I get that question a lot of time from my customers. And sometimes you guys call me and say, hey, should I put SQL Server in the same box as Configuration Manager or same as Operations Manager or Service Manager? So I normally say, hey, how much would be the load? In terms of data load, how many clients would have? A good example in Configuration Manager could be, are you going to support 50,000 clients or are you going to support 500,000 clients or less than that? I mean, 100,000 clients to 400,000
exactly.
clients, right?
Yeah.
So it all depends on the amount of data that we can load in Configuration Manager. So if you're going to use SQL Standard Edition, you can put it on the same server to support up to 50,000 clients. But if you're going to support 100,000 clients, you may need Enterprise, and you may decide to go to a remote SQL server instead to a local server. And that is a good decision for you guys to make.
So we have some sizing guidance here as far as, or some planning guidance as far as what should I do and such with that. So we have some links here around how to architect your environments based on your environment, based on your configuration. So some guidance here around how to plan out your environments if you haven't done that yet. Some good instructions here on that process.
Again, plan. We got to plan very, very well what we're going to do with some of these servers, right?
Like I said before, don't try and shortchange when you're running this stuff in virtual. Make sure you give it the specs it needs to run properly. Don't put, you know, if it's requiring an 8 gig recommendation, don't give it 4 gig in VM, expect it to work properly. You give it the resources it needs to run properly in your environments.
Another thing that we decided to bring off to you guys, to talk to you guys a little bit, is about SQL collation.
So what
right?
in the world is collation?
So what is collation? Many people ask. So as an engineer, many people tell me, oh, I actually getting this from you, Santos, and you said that I have the wrong collation in my SQL server. What should I do and why I have this big issue? So how many of you actually got this issue of collation in your environment? Anyone? You? A couple guys?
Couple.
Right. So in my environment, it's a global environment. And in a global environment, some of these issues in terms of collation may happen. Because collation is decided on what is the operating system based off, what language is defined on that. So there are two types of collation. There is SQL collations and Windows collation. I'm going to talk to you about those differences in a couple of minutes. But the main problem with collation, if you choose the wrong collation in terms of data rights, when you are actually writing information into the database, it may understand it in a different way because the language that is being used to write code into each of those databases is incorrectly set up. So it's very important for you guys to consider this option. So when you set up SQL Server, when it says collation, that little section, just analyze it, review it, and make sure that when you're setting up, you choose the right collations because this can go wrong. If you choose the wrong collation, it may impact not just one environment, but many environments. I don't want you guys to call me later on, 3 months later, say, Santos, I have some data corruption in my primary side because it has the different collation as my central side. And trust me, in 2007, I used to get and troubleshoot a lot of those.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about collation and understand what those collations are and what I actually referring to System Center. So there's two types of collation. There is a SQL collation and there is a Windows collation. In the past, System Center products were using a default collation. And this default collation is the one that is by default when I'm actually set it up the SQL. It's normally SQL underscore Latin 1 underscore general underscore CP1 underscore AES. So this is actually the default collation when we are installing SQL Server. It is on English. That will be the default collation. So many system center products only support that one as their default collation. Mm-hmm. One of them is actually Configuration Manager. That is the default collection that Configuration Manager supports. But many of the other system center product has moved into what it is a Windows collation. A good example to that could be actually Service Manager. Service Manager now needs to use a Windows collection because the way we write code, you know, we write different information into the database, we're performing a knowledge-based search. I mean, we have to put many more requirements. So that's why we start using Windows collation for some of these other products. So just remember that there's a different type of collation for each of System Center product. So validate what collection it is for these different products. So a good blog that I have that is actually Travis Wright. Travis Wright have a nice blog explaining the different collation that is for every System Center product. So we decided to bring you that link as a good reference for you guys to plan and make sure that you have choose the right collation for your SQL Server.
Absolutely.
So clustering. So a lot of people talk about clustering, all right? It has been a concept that in 2007 I used to get calls about clustering. Oh, can I cluster my Configuration Manager server? Can I cluster this other System Center product? So it all depends on what actually you're referring by clustering. I always tell, well, you can cluster the SQL side, but you cannot cluster actually the main server, right? So when we start talking about cluster, it's very important to know that I'm referring to the SQL side. So when we start building a cluster, what actually I need? So depending on the product you choose, there are many requirements. I will normally recommend my customer to start small. Start with a two-node environment, and this two-node environment to have on each node at least 16 gigabytes of RAM. This is because you're going to set up one System Center product. Remember, we were talking about the memory sizing. If you're having multiple System Center product, and this is a concept I call here the one-for-all cluster. I'm going to talk to you guys a little bit more later on. But what do you all think? Building a cluster, it is an easy thing? What you said, Brett?
Sure.
Yeah, it could be easy sometimes, but it can also be complicated. So it's good for you to plan and understand why I need that cluster, why I want to build a cluster for my environment. Do
so
I need that?
Or can not? I cluster with SQL Enterprise, or do I have to use standard, or can I use enterprise, or does it matter?
So many questions around that, right? We can use the standard to clustering, or we can use an enterprise. Yeah. Like you mentioned on Always On,
right.
We will need actual enterprise for that.
Yep.
So many customers ask me, hey, can I use my existing cluster for System
yes.
Center 2012? And I get this call all the time. So our recommendation is to have a separate instance, right? So if we have a cluster already in place, we cannot use that cluster, or we cannot use that same instance. If you have the amount of memory, and you have the capabilities to support this newer instance in your cluster, sure, go ahead and create it a new separate instance on your cluster. So it all depends in terms of that answer. I normally said, let's sit down together, let's talk about it.
Yeah.
So
if that cluster is already maxed out doing other production things and putting this onto it will only make things worse, right?
Mm-hmm.
So make sure we're not overloading our cluster with adding our System Center products onto that database server, right?
So if you have a 16 gigabyte server node already and you have another product in it, and you know that Configuration Manager minimum will need 8, maybe you cannot put another instance in that. So it's better for you guys to analyze and review that cluster before saying, yeah, let's use the same cluster, because you need those memory requirements for that instance to operate correctly. So a one-for-all cluster,
yeah.
Right?
Three Musketeers, right?
Right. So one for all for one, right? Like the Three Musketeers. So many customers start talking to me about this concept, right? What can I do if I want to have a cluster for all my System Center products? I want to build a nice cluster, Santos. I want to build a two-node cluster with 64 gigabytes. How can I perform this, right?
Sure.
It's a common question I get. So I call them, let's build a master cluster. And this is a one-for-all cluster. We're going to configure a separate instance for every single of those products. For example, Service Manager, Operations Manager, Orchestrator, mm-hmm. and Configuration Manager on the same cluster. But we're going to have memory settings for each instance, collation for different instances, and of course, we're going to have separate storage for each of these instances. So the answer to that one is all depends. If you have the power to create this type of cluster, you can definitely do that. So there are several things I can recommend on that. So I'm going to show you several things on my presentation related to that one-for-all cluster. But before I do that, there are several products that doesn't support clustering, right, Brett?
Yeah, actually there are.
So there is a product, for example, DPN. DPN doesn't support a database to be clustered. So that is not an option for me to put on my one for all cluster. But there are other products that indeed support clustering. Service Manager, Operations Manager, Configuration Manager, right, and Orchestrator could be some of those that actually support in the terms of clustering. There is a couple of products that doesn't support always on, like I mentioned to you guys earlier, right? We said that Configuration Manager and Data Protection Manager don't support always on, but some of the others support always on. So maybe in your one for all, you want to put some of these products to make some of those support abilities. Again, memory size will be important. Database option will be important in terms of storage, and also their collation. So you can build this cluster without any problems, but you got to go and set it up those different things. So I think it's actually demo time. I'm actually going to show you my one-for-all cluster. So in terms of my one-for-all cluster, I mean, let's think about that I have a big environment, right? Because I may not have a big environment for my lab, I wish, right? But I don't have it. So I'm just going to show you the different failover information that I have and how I configure my cluster to support my one-for-all. So the first thing I'm going to show you is my failover. So in my failover clustering manager, that's what I'm going to configure every single storage, the pool, and how SQL Server is going to handle their different restart options. So I'm going to show you my different roles. And right now, I only have one instance running, and my other instances are down. Because in terms of performance, I was not able to demo it out with all the memory that I wanted for here. Because, again, it's just for demo, I didn't have it. So I created, and I have it here running without any promise. I created a cluster one for all with all the different collations, the different memory settings. But in terms of performance, I have one running right now. So if you look, if you take a look, I have Configuration Manager, Operations Manager, Orchestrator, and Service Manager in the same cluster. I have a two-node cluster, and I have one right now that is down in terms of memory. And right now, it's operating between 4 gigabytes because I don't have that much in terms of my system. But in terms of node, if you take a look, I have different disk space for every single of my products. And you got to size this disk space correctly, one for the data, one for the log file, right? Where I'm going to put my TMDB in terms of that instance. So it's very important for you guys to consider that. So if you go ahead and look at my drive, I have all this drive right now running because that's what I have up. If I turn on one of my different instances, are actually going to start pulling their different storage. So for example, Orchestrator, you can see that it has different storage for each of those products, and same thing for Operations Manager. And once I start defining that, it's going to happen. So many of you may ask, but what about the protocol? What about their IP address and the protocol? So since I'm creating separate instances in SQL Server, I'm actually adding different IP address for each of those instances. So if you go into your network card, you're going to have, for example, 192.168.1.2 is one for the instance of Configuration Manager. Then you follow 3, 4, 5, like that process for every of those instances. So it's very important for Configuration Manager, for example, that in my IP settings for that, I'm actually using the same protocol, 1433. It's not dynamic because we don't support dynamics port, right? So every single of my products is using the same port, and it's using what? Different IP addresses. So when you're building the one-for-all cluster, those are kind of stuff that you should consider, right?
Absolutely.
Consider the network utilization you need, the storage, and actually how you're going to control each of these settings. So that is actually how I support my one-for-all cluster. And the other thing that you should consider in your one-for-all cluster is the restart setting. I didn't show that in my demo because I only have one instance running right now. But if I have multiple nodes running and I'm setting up my restart process, for example, you can set my restart process is the amount of nodes, 1 to n value, right? So if I shut down one of the instances, it's going to fail over to another instance. That's how it technically should be. But if I don't configure the restart setting, what's going to happen for that instance is that it's going to shut down and it's not going to fail over to the other node. So check the restart setting on each of those instances in your cluster to make sure if there is a failure, it's actually going to fail over to the other node. So ensure that that is actually happening. And what you can do is fail over those instances manually to make sure those instances are actually failing over to each of the nodes. So if you got a two-node cluster in a one-for-all, and let's happen that Operations Manager instance shut down, you're going to roll over to the other node, and both nodes are going to be operating as an active and active at that point, which is beneficial for this type of environment, right? So make sure that you are successfully in your restart, that you can ensure that you have the maximum amount of memory for each of the instances, and that you can actually move successfully that instance via the restart setting, right?
Okay, so some best practices around system center products and how our databases can be configured and tuned to meet the different needs these products have. So we have a few items on these different topics. Some best practices basically on how we can configure databases to work better.
So let's start by configuration manager, my favorite product.
Exactly,
so
mine too.
We got to start from there.
Configuration manager, right. So in Configuration 2012, rebuilding indexes task is disabled. Who did not know that? In 2007, it was enabled. 2012, it's disabled by default. So why is that, Santos?
Well, the reason to that, there isn't a specific reason. Rebuilding indexes is something that you want to consider yourself. There is two main options in the SQL aspect that we can rebuild the indexes. We can either choose the configuration manager side to rebuild the indexes. And it's something we recommend, right?
Sure.
You should actually enable the rebuild indexes in configuration manager, but you may want to decide to put it once a week, right, in configuration manager. But the other option is to go to the database side and actually create your own maintenance plan. And if you create your own maintenance plan to actually rebuild the indexes, update some of this rebuild, and actually recreate the indexes, and maybe update the status, could be much beneficial than just leave the configuration manager rebuilding indexes.
Exactly. So we have a demo on this here in a moment, the maintenance plan. Very easy to create, and great. Yeah, you definitely create the indexes, either tick the box in config manager or run the task, the maintenance plan to do it through that process. So either way is fine, right? We can also use the same idea. So the backup task in configuration manager is turned off as it was in 07, same idea. It's turned off by default. So you can enable it to back up our database and such from the maintenance task in config manager, or what else can we do?
Right, so many times in 2007, we said, you don't need to enable the backup in the SQL side. Only configuration manager backup will be supported.
Exactly.
So starting SP1, this is different now. We can actually go and enable the backup inside the SQL server. So you don't basically need that backup for configuration manager. Our recommendation will be do one backup of configuration manager once a week and then perform a daily backup of the database by creating a maintenance plan. And this will be much beneficial in terms of your database side so we can offload that performance and that management to actually SQL Server.
Exactly. We can also back up our database through DPM now, which is a new thing. So we can back up our database or our site in three ways, the maintenance task, maintenance plan to SQL, and also through DPM. So great scenarios for that. So are you saying just don't even enable the maintenance task, just use the maintenance plan in SQL and forget the task config manager?
Just as a plan A and plan B, right? How is have a plan A, which it could be configuration manager once a week, but you can have a plan B to have the backup in SQL Server enabled to every day.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
So another thing that we have in terms of the database option is the recovery model. For many years, we said we need actually the recovery model to be simple. And the recovery model to simple means that whenever we do a snapshot of that database or we do a backup, it's not going to do anything with the transaction log. So after every transaction log, if we set up as full, what's going to happen is that transaction log is going to be bigger and bigger and bigger. We don't need the transaction log in configuration manager to be restored to a point of time. So for that database option, just recovery model to simple, which is going to be much better.
There are times the DBA goes in and makes the change to make it a full recovery. We'll go in and see like a 5 or maybe a 10 gig configuration database, but see like a 20 gig transaction log. So we see really, it's obviously that's not what we want to happen. Right? A simple recovery model is what we expect, and we don't really support having the full recovery model set for our database in Config Manager.
I have seen this many times. When I'm doing assessment, I go and I validate, let me take a look at your database files. And the database is 20 gigabytes, but then the transaction log is 50 gigabytes. And I say, why? What is going on in here? So technically, right, if you have this as a recovery model simple, your log file should not be bigger than your database file. I always remember that and to validate that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So what about auto-shrink? Should we ever auto-shrink our database?
I mean, you could create a manual auto-shrink from point to time and time to time, but enabling auto-shrink by automatically is not something we recommend. We don't even recommend the auto-close. So when you create a secondary site, these two options technically are enabled by default sometimes. So if you create a secondary site in 2012, always go to that SQL Express and validate that auto-shrink is not enabled and that auto-close is not enabled, because you can create some performance impact in your database site. So no auto-shrink. Sorry, I don't recommend auto-shrink at all.
Exactly.
So demo time, Brett.
Demo time. Let's create a maintenance plan. Well, actually, two maintenance plans. One's going to run a nightly backup of our database from Config Manager. Another one's going to basically run a weekly task to run the reindex, reorganize, et cetera, like we talked about a moment ago. So we're going to create two plans here. Quite simple to do in SQL. So we go into our Management Studio again. Go to maintenance plans under management. So come into here. There's a great wizard for this. Really straightforward. So right click, maintenance plan wizard. And there's some reading here. Make sure you have your SQL Server agent started. If you don't have it running, you're going to pop up saying it's not running. Go fix it. So make sure that's running.
Right, because we're going to set this up to run either every day or every week, right? So the agent is the one that's going to control when these jobs are going to actually happen.
Right. So we'll take some notes here again. Hit next. We're going to create, in this case, we're going to create our nightly backup task first. So again, this is our config manager backup, right? Okay. So let's give it a nice little name, config manager, say daily. So it's putting a space here, a bad thing, Santos?
So like space I'm an old school SQL guy, so I don't like spaces on any of my jobs or any of my transactions or anything like that. So when I'm creating my maintenance plan, like you guys see here, I tend not to recommend spaces. In 2012, we support some of these spaces, but do what I said, right? Not use the spaces, so you're going to avoid some of these issues, right? We kind of like funky sometimes in the database with spaces, so yeah. don't use spaces.
I know for a fact a trailing space like this, the task would not run. It would throw an error saying there's an extra space at the end of your name. Go fix it. So I know we can't do that, so we'll back up one. Okay, so we have a name here, a relevant name. We're using the SQL Server agent to run this process, like we said before. We're going to give it a schedule. So we're going to choose our schedule now. It's here at the bottom of the screen. So go into change the schedule from default to our own custom schedule. We're going to run this, like I said, every morning, every night for our daily config manager backup process. So we come into here, we change obviously the occurrence to daily. Again, very straightforward. Set our time, what, 2 a.m.? Does that sound good?
Yeah, 3 a.m. is normally good.
2, 3 a.m., whatever. So we choose our time to run this process, okay? And it's going to confirm that entry here at the bottom so it knows I'm running this task, my nightly backup task at 2 a.m. every day, okay? So far, so good. We're going to say next. What are we going to do now? We're going to first, we're going to tick the box to do a backup database full. What else, Santos?
Yeah, let's do some cleanup.
How about
it's
this
It's very
one?
Important that when you guys are doing backup every day, it's going to create one single file, which is a back file. You can either append to this back file to have a history of the backup, but you may actually want to create a single file every time. So what my normal recommendation is to create this plan and actually do a cleanup. Save at least the last three backup of your SQL should be good enough. If you consider to have more, then you can put more. So let's put a maintenance to clean it up,
sure,
just in case you need it, so we can show the guys how to do that.
So we've chosen to do a full backup, again, 2 a.m. every night. And we're also going to be doing a maintenance cleanup task as well as part of this maintenance plan that we're building for this backup process. Okay, so next.
The log files? Why I'm not backing the log files? Basically, I don't need to back up the log files at this point, right? I normally recommend just doing a snapshot, but I don't really need the log files because the recovery model is simple recovery. So even if I don't back up the log files, I can basically restore it without the log files, and it's just going to recreate it because my recovery model will be simple. Now, if it was a full recovery model, I definitely will want to actually back up the log files. Mm-hmm. So it's a different concept besides the simple recovery or the full recovery.
Okay, good question. Next, we're going to choose which database to back up. So obviously, it's our Config Manager database, which is this guy here. This is our MMS Config Manager database right there. We're going to say click that box and say OK. What else do you want to say? You want to create a backup.
Yeah.
So we're going to basically identify where to store the backup file to. Default is, of course, you can put it wherever you want to. Defaults are shown here. So E drive, that's fine. What file name to apply as far as the extension? BAK, does that sound
that's
good,
right.
Santos? OK, great. So pretty much defaults here. We chose a database to back up. We set to create the database file at this location. Taking defaults for this example, that's fine. Anything else on here we need to set?
Yeah, we should be good at that.
And we're going to hit next. Now we're at the cleanup task.
Right, so remember that folder that we select in the past where we're going to store the backup, right? We're going to select the same folder at this point, and we're going to enter that extension. We put it on the E drive, right, and the extension is BAK. So we put the same folder, and then we said we want to retain this backup for every 4 weeks. And we can do that. Then every 4 weeks, what we do is we clean up all these BAKs, all BAKs that we have in the class, and we're going to put that up.
Excellent.
So in the file extension that we choose was BAK, right? So we just tie BAK on this screen, and we should be ready to go in terms of the backup for every day.
Excellent. Next. going to confirm where to write the report, the actual output text file from this process, the location there, that's fine. You can obviously change it if you want to, but for this purpose, that's fine. And we'll go next and finish.
Right. So this process normally takes a few seconds to create, but actually it's going to stay for every day, right? So once this time takes, I created today. So tomorrow at 2 a.m. is going to run this backup.
Okay, so that was our daily, nightly backup for Config Manager database, right? Now then, let's create a task to do our weekly index, reindexes, reorganizing data type process.
So instead of just doing that rebuild indexes on Configuration Manager that we choose, we're actually going to do it in the backup side. This could actually be beneficial not just for System Center Configuration Manager, but every single System Center product that you have, you can benefit from this process, right? From actually rebuilding the indexes, recreating the indexes, for all of those products. So
excellent.
What we're going to show here, we're going to show it from one database. But you can script this process and save it up, go through every of those instances that you have in your one for all cluster, and you can start doing the same maintenance tasks for those other instances.
This is, again, this is our weekly Config Manager site database cleanup process. So we're going to go ahead and create a schedule for that. So we're going to go to change here. We're going to set this to occur weekly. Sunday morning sounds great to me. What time you think, Santos?
Yeah, 1 a.m.
1 a.m. is good.
Be
great.
To do all that.
So every Sunday at 1 a.m., we're going to run this job to do some cleanup tasks on our database. Okay? It reflects that change here at the description, so we're good to go. That looks great. We'll say okay here. Onward to the next screen. Next. Again, the wizard's very straightforward. Next. So what things should I pick here? So,
Check what about shrink database?
Shrink database, you want to do that?
No. Shrink database, right? We don't want
we don't
to
do that.
So
integrity, definitely. Reindex,
that's right.
No question. Yeah, we got to have that. Rebuild index as well, yes. What about this guy?
Update static.
Yeah. So basically we're choosing these four things in this task to run again at 1 a.m. on Sunday. Okay, great. So we've chosen those items to configure. Hit next. Let's go.
So in the next screen is actually about the order, right? So technically, this is one task only, but it's actually going to do an order, right? So once one task finishes, it's going to jump to another one. Remember there was two types of schedule there. There was a simple schedule, or actually there was a separate schedule for each of them.
Right.
So if you don't want them in one task, you could create a separate schedule for each. And just remember that I choose at 1 a.m. for all of them to run in order. I can either choose, for example, shrink the database, check for integrity at 1 a.m., check for rebuild indexes at 2 a.m. I can do that as a separate schedule too. Technically, you can add the backup as here as weekly tasks. You can actually add it too. You're correct.
We split it because it's one weekly and one daily task.
Right.
Is why we split up.
That's
two
the only
jobs.
Reason we split it for
otherwise,
this demo. But you could even create a separate one as a weekly too. That's a good question.
Yes, great question. So to answer your question, so we could do this other option. Set a task, a scheduled task time per item. So run reindex at 1 a.m., run cleanup at 3 a.m. We could stagger the times. We're just basically choosing this guy to run everything in sequence in the process. So great question, though. Okay. So we chose what the things to make part of this maintenance plan, right? So next. And the wizard is, again, we can modify the order here if we chose to. We can move things up and down if we need to for our purpose. But for now, demo purpose, that looks great. Next. Again, the wizard is very easy. So which database we're going to do these tests and checks for? Our Config Manager database, again, we say okay. Next. Again, the wizard is very straightforward. Config Manager, again.
For the demo, we're choosing our Config Manager database. But if you were doing an orchestrator, operations manager, service manager, data warehouse, you will choose that. This could also be beneficial for some of the other databases, like the master database or even the TMDB. So depending on what you want to do, you can choose some of the other ones. The one that I normally don't select is the model one, which is not going to change, so I don't need anything on that model. But some of the TM database may be beneficial, even the master.
Absolutely.
So it all depends on what you're going to choose in terms of your database perspective and what are the performance you want.
So we've configured the options there. Again, we're setting it. We can set where to write the report, the output file to, right? Default is obviously there. That's fine. Leave that for now. Next. And let's do a finish.
Great.
Earlier, this VM was kind of slow. We'll see with the finish how long it takes to actually create this maintenance plan. It might take a moment. Yeah.
There you go.
So we can also, once we build a plan, how can we, modify that later?
Right, you can always modify this later, right?
Exactly.
We choose a couple of things, but later on, maybe you decide to choose to the agent send you an email, whether or not this fail or not. You can even go into your maintenance plan, like you show here. You could add, remove items, or maybe take another action. If you want to grab a file that means that it's success and send an email, you could basically do that per
right.
different item.
So, right. So we right-click the maintenance plan we want to modify, and obviously hit the modify button. It's in bold, so we know right away that's what we should be doing. And we can go through and actually change the schedule here. We can adjust the schedule this occurs. We also modify the jobs themselves by going the actual query it runs. So we can check this guy if the VM will, yeah. And we can go to edit, right?
That's right.
And we give it a minute. So we can actually view the query, the backend is running to run this task by viewing the view T SQL option here.
That's right.
Actually, I can view the actual database code behind that to make this change, right? So
that's right.
You can obviously modify that as you see fit, but okay, great. Cancel. Okay.
Great. That was a great day.
Yeah, great.
So that was actually for Configuration Manager and some of the things we think should be beneficial for Configuration Manager. You could do the same for many other products. So, Brett, how about you talk to me a little bit about Operations Manager?
So, a couple things around this. Operations Manager is a lot about data writes, not as much around data reads. So, typical recommendation there is to optimize your disks really for heavy writes, not as much around reads. So, things that can affect that kind of activity, maybe how often you collect performance data from your managed clients and servers and such. How many events you collect, how many alerts are generated during your daytime, maybe how often you run discovery, as well as configuration changes, importing management packs, tuning management packs, et cetera. Those can affect that amount of data. Again, typically it's recommended, it's heavy data writes, not as much around data reads as for ops manager. So moving forward, looking at how do we scale out our architecture for our server, particularly recommending RAID 1 plus 0 or also called RAID 10, right? For our database backend for Ops Manager. Another best practice we said before, separating our data files, transaction logs, and different partitions to maximize some of the performance around that. And again, as well, optimizing if you have the ability, write caching disk controller, enable that for 100% write caching to maximize, again, that write potential of the operating system or of the hardware platform for our database backend.
So I normally recommend when you're working on Operations Manager, depending on how many management packs you will have, I always do the sizing of your database. So if you put many management packs on that Operations Manager, it can also impact the performance on your own database server. So I always consider that, how many management packs I will have, mm-hmm. and how this will impact my database side in terms of those Operations Manager.
Absolutely.
How about Service Manager?
Yeah, Service Manager. You guys run Service Manager environments? Show of hands?
Great.
About half the room or so? Great. Okay. So the one point around the Service Manager is a data warehouse. It consists of three databases. The staging config database, the repository database, as well as the data mart. Data mart is where your reports come from. So optimizing data warehouse, there's a lot around optimizing your data warehouse so it runs efficiently serving reports to your users, your managers, et cetera. So a lot of it is around, again, maximizing the efficiency of your data mart database on your data warehouse in Service Manager. Again, all report data comes from your data warehouse. So you have a couple options. You can host your three databases for data warehouse on one SQL server, or you can split them off. You can run, basically you're required to have the staging config database and the repository database must be on the same SQL server, but you can't split off the DataMart database onto a separate server and run it as a separate box for your DataMart purposes. Okay, so again, the guidance here is efficiency, it's really around DataMart making it efficiently serve report data to the users or for reports from Service Manager, right?
One interesting piece about the Service Manager database is the Service Manager database itself needs to be on his own instance. If we are working on the data warehouse databases, he needs a separate instance just for their data warehouse perspective. So the minimum amount of memory and the maximum amount of memory for the Service Manager database itself is separate from the data warehousing. So when we start building the data warehouse for Service Manager, we need another new instance just for the data warehousing to work
exactly.
correctly.
And back at the controller, again, if we can optimize our disk controller for the staging and config database and the repository database, typically that server would recommend typically half read, half write as far as a hard drive controller goes. The data mart should be specified to be 100% read. Again, it's all about serving report data. So have the controller on that server, if it's a set dedicated box, be 100% read to serve, again, report data to your users and managers and such.
again, performance and planning, right? Making sure that you plan correctly which each of these instances under this space and memory should be will be one of those critical things that we had to do. So let's talk about Orchestrator, man.
Orchestrator
database, yeah. Right?
So who uses Orchestrator in the room?
How many are using Orchestrator?
Yeah.
Wow, great this stuff. Is impressive, so right?
That is obviously our workflow automation, right? So that's right. Kind of what that does, right? So the database in that product is used heavily by the parts of Orchestrator. Runbook servers, management servers, as well as the web components. So a poor database backend could affect runbook execution in your environment. So again, sizing SQL is really critical. As we've said a lot of times today, it's really important to get SQL backend right. You may cause issues down the road with other products in System Center. There are two data types in the Orchestrator database, configuration data as well as log data. Configuration data typically is not a source of large-scale data growth, but log data definitely can be an issue. Can cause a lot of database growth if you enable a couple options, as we'll see in the next screen. So if we look at this, so the default logging in Orchestrator does not cause issues on its own, but the additional logging available in our runbooks can cause some issues around database growth. For example, especially the activity-specific item there, that top one, the activity-specific published data could cause significant database growth if you enable that. That's meant more of a troubleshooting, debugging, logging feature. Not really meant to run production 24/7 in your environments. Only switch that on as you need trying to troubleshoot issues, resolve issues. Don't let that run forever. It'll cause database growth, no question, in your environment and Orchestrator as it runs runbooks.
So every time you build a new runbook or an Orchestrator, what you got to do? Monitor your database again. So you just start creating this automation and you want to release it to production. You may also impact the amount of size of data that you're going to grow in that Orchestrator, right? Mm-hmm. So test your runbook. Make sure that it's not going to impact that database and how it's going to be the growth. In initial size, that will be beneficial for that Orchestrator database for you guys to consider when you are building that Orchestrator database.
Great.
So in this session, we want you guys to go out for a few things, right? The minimum amount of memory for each single instance is something that you have to plan for it. You got to choose what you actually need to assign in terms of the minimum memory to get for every single instance. And the maximum amount of instance is actually needed and beneficial for some of your environment. So we want you guys to be aware of that, right? Think of your mind instead when you're building each of these instances. Minimum memory, maximum memory for each instance is something we got to do. Autogrow, database autogrow is very important to avoid performance issues on the database size. The right planning and the right amount of identification of what will be my initial size and how often it's going to grow is something you guys have to always remember about that. Being reviewing the high availabilities that we have, if you can believe, you can build that one for all cluster or all for one cluster,
yeah, like
three
musketeers,
you can definitely do that. So take advantage of the high availabilities that you can integrate into your environment instead of having four or five database servers in separate ways and maybe wasting some memory. You can take benefits of that, right? So consider the amount and frequency that the system data will flow.
Exactly.
Identify, like we mentioned, for every product, it's critical for you guys to identify what is the initial size grow and how it's going to impact the database size. If you don't plan correctly for any of this, we can definitely have some issues in your environment. Mm-hmm. Use Operations Manager to monitor your own database servers. That will be beneficial so you don't have to do that manual trace logging that we do as engineers. So go ahead and ensure you have all that available for you. So do we have any questions from the audience that want to cover now? Here's the time for us a question. If you have, you can step up on the microphone real quick. We can hear you, and we can answer that question. Microphone on?
What size do you format your disks with?
The size for the disk, I think it's very important.
8K clusters? I turned mine when I went to a virtual. I put mine at 64 clusters, and it's much
better. Right, of course. In terms of the sizing for the hard drive, we're talking about sizing of drives, right? Oh, formatting the drive? We think about that. So in terms of
that's
that,
a good question.
Yeah, that's a good question, right? So in terms of formatting the drive, and that all depends whether or not you're going to put this drive in the clustering, in a SAN storage, or they are actually virtual, right? So when you build those drives, and you set up that.
For operations manager, rate 10.
Right, like we suggest in our presentation. Right, it works much better. Right, that's correct.
I also have a lot of good luck with, and I can see a noticeable performance difference if I change the operations manager and actually the config manager database to online track, put it as a mobile app database.
That's right. That's definitely a good recommendation. I mean, if you put that, if you made that arrangement of the disk to perform much better, and you know you're taking advantage of this, it's definitely something you got to do. And it's a good suggestion for the audience, yeah?
You have to test it in your environment.
To make sure it actually works correctly.
And turn on the underlying analytical processing for operations manager, it'll be much more responsible.
Great. That's a great thing, right?
Absolutely.
Right? Yep. Anybody else have any other question? Oh, repeat it for recording? Right, is the microphone on right now? Can you step on real quick? Sorry about that.
Test.
I found through some testing in our environment, in virtual environment, that if you use format your SQL, your databases with a 64K block size, seems to be just night and day performance difference. And I also turn on online analytical processing. It's a drop down, true, false.
Right.
Operations
manager. Instead of 8KB, right?
Your console will be much more.
Perfect. Great. That's a great recommendation. Great. Thank you very much.
Yeah. So to follow up, Microsoft best practices is for database or for log files, anything like that, to DB. But where it's actually installed, like your C drive usually, your root, that still needs to be 4K. But
right.
Usually everything else is 64K as well.
Right. Thank you. Anybody else have another question?
That's great.
Yeah, can you go to Microsoft? Sorry. We are recording for the audience, so they're going to see the video again. So it's better for us to actually go through microphone. Thank you.
Yeah, it works. If I use Operations Manager to monitor my maintenance plans, will I get alerts when maintenance plan jobs fail?
In terms of Operations Manager, can we monitor the maintenance plans of the databases to check if they have failed? So whenever the agent have a triggers a failure, you're going to be notified. If you go and configure the management pack for databases in Operations Manager, this will be something you can actually trigger. You can identify whether that job actually failed, and it's going to be in the event viewer that it fails, and it's actually going to write that report. Remember, we actually write a report. You're actually going to write a report saying it actually failed, too.
Is it there out of the box in the management pack from SQL or not?
The management part for SQL, it should be that option for you to monitor some of those agent jobs, basically. It's not the maintenance plan, but remember, each maintenance plan is going to create a job inside the SQL agent, so it will be actually a job failure.
Okay, thanks.
I was just going to add one more thing to that.
Go ahead.
The one thing we've seen, the change with 2012, is jobs, the default option is to not enable to the event log. So that's one thing. If you're setting up a job versus a maintenance plan, a maintenance plan will automatically go to an event log, so that would then get written to the event log, and then Ops Manager would then pick it up as the event log. So
perfect.
We didn't go over that thing, but yeah, that's something.
Perfect. Great. Anybody else have any question?
Yeah, how about separate the data warehouse and operations manager database?
Warehouse of service manager or operations manager?
Operations manager database and operations manager data warehouse.
Right.
The same instance.
Right. I don't recommend having the same instance. It's the same concept as a service manager, right? You're going to have two different load, right? The database for operations manager, you're going to have one load, and the data warehouse, we have a total separate load. And sometimes what we do is we're going to do a transaction that is on one database, and we're going to replicate that to the data warehouse, right? So if it is on the same server, you're actually creating some sort of loop and having performance impact in that same database. So it's better if you split them into different instances, one for the operations manager database and one for the actually warehouse.
So I noticed on the rebuild indexes, you didn't talk about doing online rebuilds. Is that like, can we do online rebuilds to stop blocking on the transactions?
I think
so the question is whether or not the rebuild indexes is beneficial or whether or not is enabled by default.
Well, no, it's more of if we want to do them, shouldn't we do online rebuilds? Because if normally I think they're offline by default, and that
right.
keeps blocking.
You can do online rebuilds as manually if you want. You can go ahead and let's say you're performing some issues, is reading correctly, or the query is not typing the way you want it, and it's not returning the amount of data you want. You could either do that online or not.
Do you have or do you plan to bring out or come out with any additional best practice analyzing tools of any kind?
Right, best practice analyzing tools. So I know in terms of operating system, there are a couple of best practice analyzing tools, but to be honest with you, I'm not 100% aware if we're going to bring more tools like that to analyze some of the performance.
Okay.
Thank you. Sorry about that.
Yeah, just to follow up on the SQL rebuilding indexes, to be online, it has to be enterprise.
Right, that's correct. Right, you got to be enterprise in that aspect. Anybody else have any questions? No? We're doing good? Perfect. So don't forget to fill out the evaluation, and it has been our pleasure to meet you guys, and thank you very much for being here in MMS, and have a nice, and let's start the fun, all right?
Thanks, guys.